tired of being lonely, lonely. So baby girl, put it on me. Yeah, yeah.
This song is a sensation all over Facebook and YouTube. It's the Morosa Beer Bunda song.
Okay, listen up, my friends.
I want to tell you a story.
It's got me very happy.
You won't have to see like, know just what it feels like. Come over and dance with me. Oh,
Hey, we're back at you. You're listening to Conversations with Val and Sal, and I am Val, otherwise known as L.A. Jackson, and welcome back. I'm just glad to be back. We've been having some crazy weather here in Atlanta, but, you know, we're going to make it on through it. It's all good. God just wants to water the plants. That's how I see it. Hey, we're going to have LJ, my co-host, on in a minute. But I tell you what, I've got a really, really special guest with me tonight. I just can't believe it worked out. This didn't happen till today. But my partner in crime, my business partner, you know, my ace boom coon, you know, whatever you want to call it, my buddy Wade J3 Jones is here. He's the other half of Peach City Records. I know you've been hearing me talking about Peach City Records. And so the man himself that keeps the ball rolling is here. And we're going to just share some really, really good insight. How you doing tonight, Wade?
What's up, L.A.?
Hey, man, just chilling, man. Just good to see you, brother. I know we see each other all the time. I just got to shake your hand again, bro.
Oh, it's all good, man. You know how we do it, bro.
Yeah,
man. You know
man.
What I'm saying? It's all love up in here.
Man, I tell you what, I'm just so excited. I think this is probably going to be the best show to date because I just can't help but feel empowered when I'm around you, man. You're just an inspirational cat. You give off good vibes. You keep me focused. When I'm down, you pull me up. You know, I just can't say enough good things about you. So welcome to DashHot97.com. We're going to do this. And what our theme is tonight is just important women, and particularly important women. And I had a really interesting event that took place this weekend, and that's why I'm going to focus on important women that I've stumbled across. And I want to start off with one of them, which is Eileen Southern. And she is an author, but more importantly, she is the Professor Emerita of Music and Afro-American Studies at Harvard University. And she's probably retired or so by now. She might still be there. I don't know. But her book was called or is called The Music of Black Americans, and just incidentally, it was in one of the opening scenes of a movie featuring Wesley Snipes called Sugar Hill, and I saw it, and I just, you know, I wasn't even looking for it and happened to see it, but her book really provided a lot of good information that I got, and it embodies the entire, you know, African-American music from before, during, and after the colonial era. It also details how black music transitioned through America's colonial war, the antebellum period, civil war, emancipation, renaissance, evolution, revolution, and just way too much stuff to list in the book. But we've got some good stuff in there, and we're going to present that to you. Anyway, moving on from Eileen Southern, we have, wait a minute. I think the magic powers that be is bringing Miss LG. What do we got here? Let's see what's going on. Hello?
Hello.
Uh-oh. Is that her?
It is I.
Is that Miss LJ?
And is this L-A?
Hey, yes it is. Yes it
is. How are you?
I'm fine, girl. It's been a minute. How you doing?
Doing just fantastic on this Monday evening.
In our case down here in Atlanta on this rainy Monday evening.
Rainy, huh? All right.
Oh, look at that. The lines just lit up. It seems like every time you get online with us, folks just start calling in. The lines light up. And what's going on with you, really? What are you?
Oh, don't make me blush.
What you got going? You got some kind of magic thing going on. I mean, no one listens when I'm talking, and I'm just rambling on. And then when you get on board, man, everything... People are walking around the hallways, you know, just, I don't know what's going on there.
I don't know what to say. It's a combination that is just meant to be. How about that?
That's cool. Well, I was just telling the listeners about our topic tonight and how we're going to focus on important women out mm-hmm. there. And I was just mentioning about Eileen Southern. She was the, professor at Harvard University. She wrote a book called The Music of Black Americans, and how I pulled a lot of information from that to put into my book, Musicology 2101, A Quick Start Guide to Music Biz History. So that's kind of what we were talking about and getting into. So, we want to bring you in and see what kind of influential women both you and Wade have crossed in your lifetime and stuff like that. So we just want to take our time. I'll let you guys think about that while, I jump back into Musicology 2101. It's my baby. I've been working on it for a while. But, did you check out my Facebook page this weekend?
Now, I have to say that I stand accused.
Well,
I did not, but I know that you had something interesting going on.
Oh, yeah. You know I'm a member of the Georgia Music Industry Association. Let me drop the plug now, www.gmia.org. And it's a wonderful music organization. I'm proud to be a member of that organization. But, yeah, we had a big strategic meeting yesterday. All the board members came. And, of course, I'm the marketing director over there. So we had a lot of stuff to talk about. And out of the blue... They presented me, and I tell you what, just much love goes to Jimmy and Anya LeFevre. Jimmy's the chairman. They presented me with a special gift yesterday in honor of my book, and it was, I think it's Satchmo. It's a statue. I guess it's about 2 feet tall, and they presented it to me, and what makes it so special was they had me pull it out of this box, or pull this box out, and I was blown away. You know, the colors of my book are red and black, and this little Satchmo, I call him Mini Musicology Me. That's his name now. But he's holding the book. They got a cover of, I don't know how they did this, but they got a cover of Musicology 2101 and put it in his hand. So he's holding this book, which is my book. And then in his other hand, he's got the Georgia Music Industry Association information. And then at the bottom of the statue, it says the Jazz Man. And yeah, he's got big lips. You know how big my eyes are, girl. His big eyes were just, and he had some dark sunglasses, and the eyes were just puffed out over the glasses, and this cat's chilling. So if you guys want to check those pictures out, go to Facebook.com. I'm the Music Mon. That's DAMUSICMON. The Music Mon. So check those pictures out. I just had a ball. I was so touched, and, I just can't say enough. But I tell you what, every event I go to, I'm definitely going to be taking Mini Musicology Me with me.
I'm just really excited for you. You definitely deserve that recognition. I am just thrilled. I knew it was something special.
Well, yeah, and I tell you what, but jumping back into our topic of women again, one important woman I would definitely want to shine some light on is a lady named Bervina Brown. And in case that name doesn't sound familiar, she's the mother of slain sheriff of DeKalb County, Derwin Brown. And this lady, I met her shortly after meeting Derwin Brown. And what makes her so special is she was able to use me or utilize me for what I, and I just love to give stuff to people. So after I met her, you know, she had a little issue with her home audiovisual system. And, you know, I do, you know, home theater and all that stuff. So I went over to her house and hooked up her sound and video system and doing it. And I guess I was like a trained puppy, too, because every time I do something for her, she'd give me a big old pound cake to take home with me. And yummy, yummy, yummy. That's one of my weak points is pound cake and vanilla ice cream. But anyway, she would give me all these wonderful treats after I did stuff for her. But, you know, it's just interesting to see things from other people's perspectives. And one thing I did see with her was she was so very proud of her son, Derwin. He ran for sheriff of DeKalb County, and just before he took office, he was assassinated in his own driveway. I think they hit him with about 13 bullets, and it was a big, nasty investigation. Turned out to point back to the previous sheriff of DeKalb County, Sidney Dorsey, had, you know, a lot of stuff to do with that. But anyway, I just wanted to read a portion that I pulled and put into my book about her reaction and her feelings on Derwin Brown's murder. So if I can, I'll just go on and jump right into it. And it's this section of my book is called A Mother Speaks. On June 22nd, 1954, I gave birth to Derwin Brown. I know that the love, support, morals, and education my husband and I provided for him helped mold the man of integrity, strength, and courage that all of you came to know. Eventually, he went on to create his own family. Throughout the years, I have followed his life as well as his career, and that always made me the proudest mother in the world. Like everyone else, I have suffered a loss. As a citizen of DeKalb County, I joined you in losing a compassionate leader and great visionary, but I also lost my son. Foremost, my firstborn, and even after losing my mother and husband in my lifetime, this has been the hardest thing I have ever had to endure. And, you know, I think about that. And I have to talk about it just to have closure because, again, I was good friends with Derwin Brown and his family. And, you know, it's just watching the other things that people go through is just amazing. And one other point I want to make is that Derwin's wife named Phyllis, she passed away shortly, you know, a couple years after Derwin. And so the whole point I'm trying to make is just from Derwin alone getting killed, you know, two more lives were shattered, and both Derwin's wife and mother ended up passing away. And Miss Bervina left us on March 7th, 2009, and Phyllis Brown died in 2006 on Christmas Eve.
Wow.
You know, just 3.5 years after, you know, Derwin's death. But that's just something, you know?
You know, that is the most saddest story. And it just, as you were talking about it, made me think about how greed, power, and the corruption. I mean, you know, I read that story. I followed that story for a while, and, you know, it was just incredible that, you know, his own colleague, basically just because of what the immense jealousy that he felt for him, you know, took the life of this leader, community leader, husband, son. You know, and I can't imagine that must have just created a tremendous heartbreak for the both of those women.
Yeah, it's just terrible. And there's more things that happened personally, but we won't get into them in this show now. Different things with that between me and Derwin's son as well. And Wade, what kind of women have been, you know, influential or made some kind of difference with you, brother?
I think anytime you start thinking about women, I think the first thought is with your mother. Mm-hmm. And my mother was a single mom, and she raised four of us. Very proud woman, an activist, an educator, and I think I draw my strength from her first and foremost.
Okay. That's nice, man. And your mother was a very, very special person. On top of giving birth to you, she was also married to the first artist on Motown that was on Motown before Motown was Motown. And even though it sounds kind of crazy, why don't you explain that?
Yeah, well, my mom and my dad are from a small town in Michigan, right outside Detroit, Pontiac, Michigan. And my dad, Wade Jones Jr., was Berry Gordy's first artist on a label he started before he started Motown.
What was the name of that?
It was Ray Bear Records.
Ray Bear Records, that's right. I think I talk about them in the book, though.
Right, you do. I appreciate that, too, man. But my dad was his first artist, and one of my dad's deceased now, but one of my uncles talks about how he remembers Berry Gordy as well as Smokey Robinson coming by my grandmother's house and asking them could Wade come down and sing. And they did. He did two songs. One, I Can't Concentrate, and the other song was done by
Insane.
Thank you, LA. Done by which was written, and both songs were produced by Berry Gordy, but Insane was written by Smokey Robinson and Berry Gordy as well. But my grandmother was also a rock. Both of my grandmothers had come from two large families. Both of them left the South. Both of them left Mississippi.
Wow.
In the during the Jim Crow era.
Okay.
Left there and moved to Michigan and settled in Michigan. Like I said, it's Pontiac, Michigan, right outside Detroit.
Wow.
And so I have a total of 20 aunts and uncles.
Oh, my gosh.
So I had those grandmothers, those traditional grandmothers
strong,
in L.A.
Strong,
yeah.
Strong. Wasn't scared to crack that whip.
They were the rocks. They cracked the whip. They made sure you went to school.
Yeah.
They made sure you was dressed right.
Mm-hmm.
They made sure you behaved yourself.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And they were probably between my mother's and my grandmother's, probably the most influential women in my life.
Wow. Well, speaking of influential women, actually wasn't a woman, but these influential women gave birth. I mean, not your mother was married to your father, who was an influential artist as far as Motown was concerned.
Right.
And then your grandmother gave birth to someone who was another influential artist. Why don't you tell us about him?
Right. Well, she's first cousin. My grandmother, Maddie Jones, which is Maddie Cook at first, is the first cousin of Sam Cook.
Wow.
You know, and God bless Sam.
I love all of
this
music.
Oh,
yeah. And, you know, and the Cooks, they're still up there in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, when we hold family reunions, my great-great-grandmother was Julia Cook.
Wow.
So, but, yeah, man, you know, I come from a strong lineage. And like I said, the whole thing of it is, L.A., is that the women were the backbone.
Mm-hmm.
Of the family.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Amen.
So, and it just, nothing happened without them knowing it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And if they didn't know it, they find
they
out.
Found out.
in their own way.
And
you know
action.
What I'm saying? Hey, what the grandkids were doing,
yeah.
What the nieces were doing, what the nephews were doing, and things like that. But, you know, I think you picked a fantastic subject for today.
Okay.
And women, I mean, we're here in the studio. And there's a young lady behind the board. There's
oh,
a young
man.
Lady that
She's
I just
a
met.
Very, yes.
It just goes to show you, man,
Miss
that
Ash.
Women are they certainly, and women are very empowering. They're very influential
very uh-huh.
in the business world,
yeah.
in the corporate world,
yes.
you know. And I think once we can, you know, really, you know, we get to know our sisters and understand them,
mm-hmm.
then it becomes easier for us to do business with them.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know what I'm saying? And deal with them on a different level.
And speaking of doing business on a different level, you know, we've got some artists that you deal with on a daily basis at Peach City Record, and we're going to get into that. But right now we're going to bring up some music off the Exposure CD. And this is my good friend Elliot Holder with a song called Johanny. And this was written about a woman. We're going to tell you about that right after the song finishes. Here's Elliot Holden with Johanny.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just love that song, and just when I'm about to do the cue and fade out, I remember how beautifully it ends, and I'm like, man, it just has to run all the way out. But Johanny is a song that Elliot wrote about a girl that he knew, and I think she became homeless or something, and she wound up sleeping in her car and somehow mysteriously died and, you know, passed away, and he just felt so touched about her that he had to write that song. And I tell you what, God bless him, and, you know, God bless Johanny, resting in heaven. But
beautiful. I really enjoyed that. It's so smooth.
Yeah.
Yeah,
he is a great guy, great artist, and there's more great music on the Exposure CD. As a matter of fact, that CD opens up, track number 2 on there is by a special young lady, and the last song on there closes out the CD by another special young lady. I'm going to let Wade talk about those two young ladies, and then we're going to find out what influential ladies are in your life, LJ.
All right, LA.
Yeah, well, you know what? I want to stop and say hello to LJ because I had
met her. Oh, sorry. That's not
Yeah, how you doing, LJ?
Doing real well, Wayne. Just enjoying your testimony about your rich family history. That's great.
Oh, yeah.
Shout out back to you.
I appreciate that. And we'll talk because LA's told me a lot about you now. You know what I mean?
All right. Sounds good.
Yeah. But we have two artists on our label, Peach City Records, Kimosha LeToi and Onny. Kimosha is originally from VA, and she's been working with us. She's our first artist.
The first lady of Peach City.
First lady of Peach City, and she's a dynamic sister, beautiful, just a pleasure to be with, great spirit, and one heck of a singer and a songwriter.
Mm-hmm.
The song that L.A. opens the show with, Eyes Stuck on Me, mm-hmm. is a song that's written by Kimosha and produced by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be her first single. Onny is a 16-year-old. She's originally from Detroit, Michigan. Mm-hmm. She is Nigerian.
Mm-hmm.
She's born here in the States, and she's a phenomenal singer and songwriter as well. And Onny also produces as well, so I'm working on her with that and really honing those skills. But they're just two ladies, and the thing about it is when LA and I came up with the concept for the record label, our thing was the fact that there's so many talented young people here in Atlanta,
yeah.
and they're just walking around the streets.
Mm-hmm.
And God has just brought us two just wonderful young ladies. They've been very dedicated to us. They've been very committed,
mm-hmm.
and they want to be successful. So, you know, the thing for me in LA is to make sure that they are successful. And that just goes to show you that, you know, even in today's culture where, you know, we're texting and we're Instagramming and, you know, we're doing everything very spontaneous and things seem just so, you know, wishy-washy, kind of, you know, just kind of microwave, you know, it's kind of a microwave age. But there are people out there that are, you know, still solid, have good character and, you know, just good, positive young people out there, you know, and young women especially.
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, Lori, or LJ, what tell us your influential woman story.
I'm really excited because, you know, to piggyback on what Wayne said about, you know, of course, first and foremost of influence, you think about your mom.
Mm-hmm.
And my mom, she didn't really, you know, have particularly in herself as far as any musical, like singing and things like that. But my mother enjoyed good music.
Wow.
And
so
I loved to watch her enjoy good music. So much so that, you know, that created a love for music because I saw what it did for my mother. I saw what it did to her, mm-hmm. LA and Wade. And in coming up as a young girl, I remember the greatest song that when I got old enough to research it, to find out who the artist was,
mm-hmm.
and to research the artist, it just the vibe of that song and watching my mother and how and what it did to her, mm-hmm. it never left me. And the song is called Pata
Sparker.
No way. You are
Miriam Makeba. I'm trying to tell you.
Do you know that's Mama the next Africa. Artist I was going to talk about was Miriam? Oh my God, this is really God at work.
And listen, this is I watch my mother. I'm telling you, when that song, my mama would play that song over and over, and I would just be mesmerized, just the rhythm of the song, just watching my mother, just watching her. Mama Africa, definitely Miriam Makeba was some type of woman.
Wow.
And just to touch on a little bit about her background, of course, she was a civil rights activist, mm-hmm. South African singer,
mm-hmm.
And she made African music she popularized it, of course, around the world.
That is crazy.
Of course, was very outspoken against apartheid, and she was exiled for that. But that song stuck with me from a little girl. I'm telling you,
and
that was that's just the most vivid when you talked about your musical influence of a female.
Yeah.
She popped right in my mind, and I didn't even say anything to you when you said it. I thought
I can't. Ladies and gentlemen, I swear to God, this was not staged. I've got page 83 in my book opened up to the section on Miriam Makeba right now. I just can't believe you said that, Lori. And oh my goodness, my pata pata story is that my mother had a friend up in the Bronx, because we grew up in Brooklyn, or else I would have never met you. But anyway, her friend Miss Enid Roberts, they were old friends from Jamaica, and they moved up to America at two different times, and mysteriously ran into each other again and rekindle their friendship. But we would go up to the Bronx, and living in Brooklyn, we would have our Jamaican parties, and 10 million Jamaicans came out of nowhere and partied all night and everything. But we'd go up to the Bronx and have parties up there at Miss Roberts' house, and she had a whole bunch of daughters, and I had a crush on a couple of them. But there was one named Kay Dean, and I just always had a crush on her. She was like right about my age, and I just knew we were going to grow up and get married to each other, and it just never happened. I never even got a kiss from that girl. But that's a whole nother story. But we'd go up to the Bronx, and we'd have these parties, and out of all the parties, that was one song that I always remembered, was that Pata Pata. And I tell you what, I call Miriam Makeba the MVP of Team TAW, which is Team Talented African Women. And one of the interesting things about her was she was married to a couple of different notables. One was a singer named Sonny Pillay. And I'm not too familiar with him, but I am very familiar with another husband she had named Hugh Masekela. And
Hugh Masekela, yeah.
That's right.
Even Stokely Carmichael.
Mm-hmm. And he was the next one I was just going to mention. And Stokely Carmichael, if people remember, was a very, very heavy-duty civil rights activist.
Absolutely. So, just touching on Hugh Masekela, another powerful song, Soul Makossa.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, and all of that stuff is written about in my book. So definitely check out Musicology and get the stories behind all of those. But Pata Pata was an interesting song because she wrote that song and did it, and I think it hovered around the world for maybe 10 or 15 years before it even made it to America to become the hit that it became. How about that?
Wow. Yeah, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
That is great. Big ups to Miriam Makeba. And did you know that, I forget what the story is there, but I think, there it is. She spent her first 6 months of life in jail because she was in her mother's stomach, and her mother was an activist. So while her mother was pregnant, she was in jail, and so Miriam was in jail. Ain't that something?
That is great.
That
wow,
is.
You know, hey, chip doesn't fall far from the block, as the old saying goes, huh?
That's something else. And another friend I want to give, actually, she's a cousin, a good friend and cousin, my cousin Valerie. She has made many, many trips to Africa, back and forth, from Jamaica to Africa, from America to Africa, just back and forth. And she's traveled and went to lots of different countries. So if anybody's going to plan on traveling to Africa, they should definitely touch base with her because she knows all the ins and outs. She's made a lot of trips to back and forth to Africa. She's got a book out called African Hospitality, and it is online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, all the usual places. But she's made a lot of trips, and she just kind of documents the adventure she had in her travels. So we're going to pull up some more music and take a little break, I believe, and come on back and, you know, pick back up on one more person I want to talk about. Let's see what this one is. Okay, this is Juwan Jackson, a good friend of mine, and she's got a gospel song called Purpose. Check it out.
I was created in His image for a reason, destined for greatness and I feel so obligated to follow His footsteps. He left so clear in the sand and I'm up. Slow down, full speed ahead, till I reach my destination, that's the plan. And I know that I can't wait, as I go hard to be here to fulfill a purpose. Yeah,
said that we are more than conquerors through Him in Christ Jesus. And we just want to remind you that the battle is not given to the swift, nor to the strong, but in the doing to the end.
I'm a conqueror, I'm a soldier for Jesus. Since I believe in Him, I'm an overachiever. I'm a standard high, so I have something to push for. When I come knock, knock, knocking at His door, He won't tell me no. This is Daddy Heaven's story.
Well, we were we're not related, but I wish we were. That was the Jackson sisters with my good friend Juwan Jackson. We used to work together, and that song was called Purpose. And yeah, Lori, go on and finish up your story with you know, you were talking about your mom and Pata Pata and all that stuff.
Well, hallelujah. And you know, you have to correct me, you know, because I got too excited. Hugh Masekela, I got it mixed up. Manu Dibango, actually, he was the one who wrote performed Soul Makossa. You could have corrected your sister.
I could have, but I just figured.
You're the music monitor.
And I've got both of them in the book, so you know I knew that, but I just didn't want to say anything.
You didn't want to throw me out there under the bus. That's all right.
I just figured I'd just keep it on moving, and, you know, people would buy the book and figure it out later.
Okay, no problem. You just covered me with your love. I understand.
That's how we do it.
Well, okay. Just to finish up talking about, you know, mom and watching her enjoy music and watching her just, you know, do the house party thing, you know, because people back in the day, of course, you know, they'd be at home and just, you know, have their nice adult drinks and just have a good time right in the house. And, you know, they send you off to the room, you know. But definitely I would always watch her enjoying her music. And if I had to talk about somebody who may have had some, you know, musical kind of a bend towards maybe being a vocal artist was my grandmother. She used to sing in a, you know, of course she sang at church. She sang on the choir. She loved singing on the choir. And those roots always seem to, you know, be resident with our community, you know, being singing in the church. And so I watched her sing on the choir. Mm-hmm. And they did a little traveling thing for a while with a traveling gospel group. You know, for a while. Nice. And if I did more in-depth research, I probably would come up with some really cool things about that part of my grandmother, and I just purpose to do that even more. But, you know, the love for music definitely it was introduced, number one, watching my mom, you know, my grandmother watching her in church. I didn't grow up in church, but I mean, when we came down here, when we visited and everything here in South Carolina, I definitely watched her. You know, do the choir thing, and that was a very important part, you know, of my foundation in the love for music. So thank you for letting me share that, L.A.
Wow, that's just amazing. The fruit don't fall too far from the tree, obviously, because you've got all these musical forerunners in your family, and it just kind of filtered down. But you kind of bridged the gap because you did some singing in a group as well as being a gospel DJ or radio host. So, you know, that's just, man, I'm so proud to know you.
Oh, you stop. I'm proud to know you. Definitely that. I do. I really, really enjoy music. I may not, you like the technical, the slice and dice, get to the root of music in the foundation, which that's good too. You know,
well, God,
you like to feel good
in
the vibe of it as well.
That's right. That's right. He just puts us in the place that we're supposed to be, I guess.
That's the truth. Amen.
What else you got on your side?
What else I have on my side?
Other influences, and it doesn't really necessarily have to be music, else comes to mind. I know your daughter's a great influence because she was dancing with Nappy Roots, and I had a chance to work with her and meet her, and she's another wonderful person. If she was my daughter, I would just be so motivated to keep doing stuff. I mean, she's just a wonderful, and again, tell little Miss Essence I said hi. That's your little mini-me.
That's my mini-me. Yeah, definitely. She loves to dance. She, I guess we all get that, honestly. But, yeah, she had that time with the Roots and Nappy Roots and definitely traveling with them for a season there.
Mm-hmm.
And my other mini-me, which is Ebony, Essence, Ebony, and Errol are my
wow,
children.
Wow, the three so E's, okay.
The three E's, yeah. So Ebony is in New York. She is in the fashion industry, works at a modeling agency, loves it very much. And my son, he likes to work on cars, take them apart and put them back together.
Okay. Well, I'm going to have to bring my car up to him sometime.
How about that? But I mean, music, definitely, if I had to pick a modern day influence, I would say one of my all time favorite female singers would be Anita Baker.
Nice.
Yeah, definitely. She's smooth. You know, I just love her the way she really sings from the depth of her soul, you know, and, you know, of course, there are many, many others, but, you know, that classy, you know, female, of course, the great Whitney Houston, you know, Patti LaBelle.
Oh, definitely.
Those are, yeah, definitely those are the, the kinds of ladies, the late Phyllis Hyman, you know, just to name a few.
Yeah, I had a chance to see Phyllis Hyman just before she passed. She did her last performance here. I don't know if it was a last performance period, but I know it was just a couple months before she passed away, and she was ironically on the same bill as Stanley Clark and George Duke, who just passed away last week. And I tell you what, she was a tall lady, and that's all I remember. She had this big hat on, and she was just so big and tall, and, you know, I saw like a little flashback of Billie Holiday in her, and just, man, I tell you what, have you ever seen her perform?
I have not seen her perform, but yes, she is. I can imagine seeing her in person because she was tall in stature, you know.
Yeah.
So I can imagine seeing a woman like that singing like how Phyllis used to.
Goodness,
man, I'm
that
telling
presence,
you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that presence, right. That presence, LJ, absolutely.
And then Anita Baker, I think I saw her perform. I'm getting old, as you all know. But, you know, Anita just recently either went on tour or did a tour, but I saw some advertisement for her.
She performed here several weeks ago at Chastain Park.
Chastain Park, that great place to perform.
Yeah. And you know what? One of Kimo's cover songs is You Bring Me Joy by Anita Baker.
Great song.
Yeah,
great
song.
Yeah.
So watch out for that. Boy, I tell you what, we got some great stuff coming from Kimo.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Well, yeah. I've got one more lady I'd like to talk about, and that's a lady named Carmen George, and she's a very special lady to me. I've known her just as long as I've known you, and we're going to go into some music, and when we come back, we're going to talk about her. Coming up is another track off the Exposure 3 CD. Let's see if we can figure it out. All right, that's Jonna Jong. She's a female guitarist, and boy, is she good. Check this song out. It's called Another Blues. What a great song. That was Another Blues by Jonna Jung. And she's just, I had a chance to see her open up for Elliot Holden. And Wade, you should have seen it, man. She sat on that chair and it didn't look like she was doing anything. But when the stuff coming out of that speaker just hits you over the head, oh, Lord, Lord, Lord. Mm. Anyway,
yeah, I like the song.
Yeah, man, just great song. Like yeah, that exposure, the CD is just incredible. I got some great artists on there, and thank God for every one of them because I shouldn't be a fan because I put it all together, but it makes me become a fan. I love to listen to it.
That's why you did it, because you're fans of all these people.
Man, I tell you.
You're a special guy, man.
Mm-hmm. Well, he is, isn't he?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what. We're going to kind of start wrapping things up. And like I said, I want to talk about Miss George, Carmen George. I think her middle name is Amancia, Carmen Amancia George. And she's,
I think you're right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she's from, I think her family's from like the Virgin Islands, the Dominican Republic. She's a true matriarch because she was married to a man named Lucian George who became, the father of her children. And what makes her so special to me is I've been like down there life. We, LJ, have been lifelong friends of her three sons, Paul, Lou, and Brian, the mm-hmm. three key members of Full what?
Full Force in the Place to be.
That's right. And they were also in a house party. They were the bullies in house party. And, you know, everybody remembers Lou from the I'm going to kick your
His signature, yeah. Definitely.
And they're going to, I think Lou's going to be down here next week for the Peachtree Village International Film Festival. So we're definitely planning on hooking up. I spoke to him on Saturday. And I also spoke to his mother that day, too. And I tell you what, the thing that's really touches me about Miss George, or Mama G, as I like to call her, mm-hmm. is that I told her about my book, like, 10 years ago when I was thinking about starting it and blah, 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 and she encouraged me to get going, and I got going, started writing it. And since that point, I think last year, Full Force, they put out a book, but I've been on her to help her, you know, try to get a book going. I told her about a voice recognition program. She went out and got it, put it on the computer. I helped her load it up when I went up to visit a couple years ago. And she's just been so busy trying to, you know, I mean, throughout the years, raising her sons and helping them, you know, secure performances and stuff like that. Like I said, we reunited when Columbia signed them around 1986. They were producing Lisa Lisa and Cult Jam. They had a big, huge hit, I Wonder If I Take You Home, and a couple other songs. But Miss George has been there the whole time with her sons, raising her sons. And, of course, they produced James Brown, Gerald Levert, the Backstreet Boys, NSYNC, Britney Spears, the list goes on and on. But she's always told me, you know, I want to get a book out too, and I want to write a book. And she's told me all these different stories that's happened to her and stuff she's gone through. And, you know, she called me on Saturday, and it just stuck with me how she, just to hear it in her voice, she said, I know you got me this program, and, you know, I want to get my book going on it, but I'm just worn out. I'm just too tired to do it. And my heart dropped when I heard that, because she's been the background, backbone, just like Wade said. She's been the matriarch and backbone of her sons and the whole Full Force in the Place to Be movement and everything. And she's been there for her sons. And, you know, even to this day, they're getting booked. There's all kinds of projects. They're running around. And she's still in the middle of the mix, and you know now of course they got kids, grandkids, and so all of these people bombarding her, pulling her every which way, and you know, God bless her. And
she's that rock. Huh?
She's that rock. You know?
That's a good word, matriarch. Yeah. What you said. That's the person. She's the rock of that family. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what you're talking about.
And I just want to help her any way I can. And now that you know my book is out the way, I'm certainly going to do whatever I can to help this lady get her book out because she has got a story. I mean, she was married to their father before they were born. She told me about, and I guess it's no secret that people from the island like to party, and she told me about all that stuff, and I was like, I can't even picture you partying, Miss G.
Miss G went all the way, Miss G.
I guess that's where those boys, right. Those babies came from. But not only dealing with her sons, but she told me a couple of stories about dealing with, like, the pen pals for Full Force and how she developed relationships with families and other people. And one girl wrote and wanted to be her pen pal, and then she died, and then the sister jumped in and picked up, and then she interacted with the children and just all this thing. So this lady is just to find an open heart like that, that just so willing to give. You know, my mom is like that, too. She wants to do stuff for people, cook for people, and just give the last ounce of energy to other people. And it's always amazed me because I've been kind of selfish myself.
Right.
I want to do it all for me. And, you know.
Right, it's about me.
Yeah. So,
you're just protecting yourself, right?
Yeah. I mean, I love my friends and everything, but even a stranger, they would reach out and do stuff for strangers. And, you know, my mother gets letters in the mail, even to this day, from the veteran stuff. And if I don't catch her, she'll give away all her money writing little checks out right. to these people. And I'm like, Ma, do you know these people? Do you know who they are? Like, no, but God says, you know. I'm like, man, just something else.
Right.
Wow.
Those
wow.
matriarchs, man. Like matriarchs, you said, man. You know? So,
yeah,
you know.
And they just, you know, not too long ago, I think it's like, not even been maybe 2 years that their grandmother died.
Yep,
I
mean, she told me about burying her, yep.
Wow. Yeah, her
mother.
She was 100?
Yeah,
I was
going to say, I wonder how old she was.
Dude, you wouldn't believe it. She told me about so many people in their family that lived to be well over, like 111 years mm-hmm, old and all these people. So they're eating right or living right, and you know what Miss George told
jeans,
me?
Bro.
Yeah, and she told me, well, you know, back in those days, they didn't have a lot of TV, so they was, you know, working it out and, you know,
yeah.
doing things and
physical activities.
You know what I mean.
Right. we did it. Yeah, definitely. So, she took that pretty hard, too, because I'm sure, you know, definitely, you know, she was her caregiver, I believe.
Oh, yeah, yeah. She told me the whole story about the nursing home. And, you know, one of the boys, Paul, one of them from Full Force came and said, hey, you know, grandma's getting old. Maybe we should think about putting her in a nursing home kind of thing. Mm. And she lost her mind. She cussed them out. She hung up the phone on them and everything. But over time, you know, dementia, different things started happening. And she, unfortunately, was able to just give up, you know, the living with her or being in charge of her health and everything. But she would visit her all the time. And even to this day, even though it's been a couple years, LJ, she still grieves about her mother because she was they were really, really good friends.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, definitely. So, absolutely.
So, hopefully.
Great, yeah, she's a great woman, that's for sure. And I imagine trying to keep them grounded was really, you know, I remember her telling me that, you know, I've had the privilege of talking to her many times myself, her and my mom. Mm-hmm. You know, she always asked about Miss Johnson. Did you know that the parents always, being at, you know, my mom was a teacher in the school,
right.
You know, and so she would always ask about my mom. I believe she had, I think it was Lou in one of her classes my mom did. So, you know, her and my mother, she always often asked about my mother.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I remember her telling me, keeping them grounded throughout the years, you know, so that whole thing wouldn't go to their heads about being Full Force, you know. You know, that definitely was something that she was able to do in being so close to their lives and, you know, with everything that was going on, you know, throughout their lives. And also, to their credit, the unsung, you know, TV1's Unsung.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that came last year.
That one was the most, I think it was, Lou likes to say it, like one of the most highly rated.
Absolutely.
Because it wasn't so sad.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of times, you know, those unsung stories, they can be so depressing.
Oh,
you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Oh, yeah. The one
a lot of tragedy.
Yeah, the one
tragedy,
on the Force
exactly.
MDs was had a lot of tragedy was riddled through the Force MD story.
Yeah. Yeah.
This man.
We met, they were down here promoting that, and L.A. had me and a bunch of artists and musician friends. We came down and met them at their club where they were at. Yeah, they came down, and matter of fact, we met, what's my man named P? He was the producer.
Oh, the producer. I forget his name.
Yeah,
but
P or something like that.
Yeah, P is something, a letter and then a name, and he's going to be down here again for the next week as well for the Peachtree Village Film Festival.
But that's real cool that you and L.A. both know her like that. I bet she was amazing. You mean your mom taught one of those boys in school?
Well, my mom was what you call a teacher's assistant.
Oh,
well,
gotcha.
They called them paraprofessionals at the time. They did most of the
work. My mom did a very similar job to that.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I know exactly what you're talking about. Wow. So you guys been knowing them for forever, huh?
A long time.
When they were called the Amplifiers.
The Amplifiers, that's right. And you know, Brian or Lou, one of them told me that... and I'm not going to say no names, but one of them did not like to perform, and he used to get whippings all the time just to get out on stage. Ain't that something?
Yeah, they did what they had to do, didn't they?
I'm like, y'all are so great. How you not want to do that?
I
called that was my connection to the Jackson 5 back in the
70s. I know that's right.
That was the closest I was going to get was knowing those guys.
Right.
You know? So that's really cool, man. But wow. I tell you what, it's just great to know these guys, to still know them. And I certainly expect to do some work with them musically as well, with our artists or through their stuff that's going on. But somehow, some way, I know we're going to be in the studio doing some stuff and chopping it up. And LJ, we're going to have to send for you and bring you on in there, too.
Oh, I know, and I'm on my way, working on it.
Cool.
Yeah, I'd like to see you, could have you come up here and we do this in person.
Yeah, she's a pint size. Yeah. She's about the same size as Kimo.
Oh, yeah. Well, hey, you bet she pack a big punch, though.
Oh, yes. That's right.
I'd love to be there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, indeed.
So we're going to close things out, but let me leave you with this. Thanks to my guest, Wade Jones, and my co-host, LJ. And remember, God needs us all to do something good for him. But first, we have to do something good for ourselves.
There you go.
All right, we'll catch up with you guys tomorrow, 7 to 8 on www.hot97.com. Conversations with Val and Sal.
Good night.
Here's Kimo. Take us out, girl.
Hey, what's up to me? Before someone sees what's up with me, better keep your eyes up on me. 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 And if you wanna be the one that got him be, come closer, grind slowly while you're near me. You won't have to see like, know just what it feel like. Come over and dance with me. You better keep your eyes. To the beat, babe, slowly caress my skirt. Come closer, come and watch me work. Your boy's choosing, you better make a move, babe. Boy comes over here and make a move, babe. I still got my eye on you. Just like I know you see me too. Better keep your eyes up on me. 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 Come closer, grind slowly while you're near me. You won't have to see like, know just what it feels like. Come over and dance with me. You better keep your eyes stuck on me. Thank you.
thank you guys for tuning in to Dash Hot 97 with Trisha Dash. We just heard Conversations with Val and Sal on Dash Hot 97. If you guys have any phones, any song requests, please dial 770-574-4355. I got Sierra and 50 Cent.
50 Cent. Sierra. I'm focused, man.
Dog child.
You should know this, man. Just one dose of me, I had you addicted. To know me, still love me, I handle my business. Any city, any town, touchdown, I do my thing. I'm a hustler, baby, I provide by any.